Yeah, praise the Lord, God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Thank you, King Jesus, for the shed blood. Thank you for our salvation. Thank you for being so merciful. As a father pities his children, so you pity us, Lord, because we fear you. We thank you for shedding your precious blood to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, to give us your righteousness in exchange for our sin that was placed upon you on the cross. What an exchange. May we always glory in what you did for us. So awesome, so wonderful, so beautiful you are. Lord God, we are here to listen to what you have to say. May you open up our understanding. Give us wisdom. You said if any of us lacks wisdom, let us ask of you, and you will fill us. Hallelujah. You will fill us to the brim so that our cup will even run over. Hallelujah. And so right now we're open with our mouths wide so that you would fill it with the truth of the gospel. Hallelujah. The truth of your word, the truth of the scriptures. Help us, Lord God, to understand so that we may glorify you in every way, in every thought, in every action that you lead us to take, so long as we have the breath of life on this earth. Have your way, O Lord, in Jesus' name, praying for the peace of Jerusalem. Amen. Thank you for coming back to another teaching installment of When the Temple in Heaven is Open, Everything Will Change. And today, wanted to talk about a question that I had on my page about the 3 days of darkness. And I looked it up and did some research, and I'm going to tell you what the Bible says, you know, about the Bible, because everything is truly written in the Word for our learning, so that we may find hope and comfort and knowledge and wisdom and truth in the scriptures, because God has told us the end from the beginning. So there's no reason to doubt about what God is about to do. There's no reason to, you know, make up our own theories about what God is about to do, because God has told us in his word what he is about to do. And so let's go to the word to figure out what these 3 days of darkness is, if there is even 3 days of darkness connected to when the day of the Lord begins and the rapture. Okay. So right here, we're just looking at a picture of what happened in ancient Egypt when Moses called down the seventh plague upon Egypt. And that seventh plague of hail was devastating to the land of Egypt. After the seventh plague, on the heels of the eighth plague coming, the Egyptians cried out to Pharaoh and said, let the people go because Egypt is destroyed. Okay, Egypt was destroyed by the seventh plague. Okay, the seventh plague even had the wise men, the people of Egypt, begging for Pharaoh to let the people go because of the utter devastation that the seventh plague had upon Egypt. And because the seventh plague of Egypt is a foreshadow of what is about to happen in our days, we can look at the pattern that God has given us, okay, in the Word of God. Okay, we know that the end times, what's about to happen, okay, what is about to happen in our day, when it happens, the order of events is given to us in the book of Revelation. And the shadow of the events is given to us throughout the Old Testament. Okay, and even in the New Testament, in the Gospels, we're going to hit some of that. God gives us exactly what's going to happen when this day comes. So the Bible says that when this day comes, it's going to be a regular day when it all begins. Okay, there's not going to be any warning. That's why God repeatedly tells us that we must watch and pray always. That's what the Bible says, okay? God says watch and pray always. not sometime, not here and there, not a little bit, not a few times. He said, always watch and pray. Why? So that you, me, everybody who names the name of Christ will be counted worthy to escape all the things that are about to come on the earth and stand before the Son of Man. Okay? God didn't say we're going to escape some things, most things. He said all things, okay? All things we can escape if we watch and pray always, okay? Because God says that he's going to come at an hour when we think not. He's going to come like a thief in the night upon a world who's not looking for him, who's not watching for him, who's not praying to him, okay? But for those who are in relationship, those who are in covenant with the Most High, those who have been born again, who have set their seal to this, that God is true. God has made an escape route. And that escape route is called the rapture, the snatching away, the harpazo. Okay. And God says that he's going to come and he's going to receive us to himself. Okay. But on the day that this happens, hallelujah, on the day that this happens, it's going to be a regular day. There's not going to be any warning. There's not going to be 3 days of darkness that's going to warn the world and for the body of Christ to get ready to prepare themselves. Okay, no. The Bible says in the parable of the 10 virgins that as all 10 virgins slumbered and slept because the bridegroom was delayed, at about midnight, a cry rang out. Hallelujah. And when that midnight cry rang out, the herald said, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Okay. And when the bridegroom came, the Bible says that only five of the virgins were wise because they had oils in their lamps. They had oil in their lamps and they were ready. Okay, and the Bible says that the door was shut. Okay. There was no warning when the midnight cry went out. Those who are ready went in and the door was shut. Those who weren't were left behind and they were knocking on the door, begging to get in. Okay. If you're left behind on the day when everything goes up, when everything goes up in smoke because the fire comes down, because our God is a consuming fire, hallelujah. If you're left behind on that day, you will beg, okay? You will beg, especially if you know him, okay? Well, especially if you had a convenient relationship with the Lord, but yet on the cloudy day, your sin found you out. Yes, if you were one of the unwise virgins who knew about the Lord, who knew our Master's will, but yet you prepared not your house, well, God's going to find you out. And if he spares you, hallelujah, from the cloudy day judgment, if he lets you live, you will beg, hallelujah, to be let in, but the door will be shut. And so now it's time that you pay the price of your life during the 7-year tribulation. Okay, but I'm getting kind of ahead of myself, but the point is that Jesus Christ says that it's going to be a day just like every other day. And the two examples that God gave us, we find in Luke 17 about that day when Jesus Christ says he's going to come, okay? When Jesus Christ says he's going to come like the lightning flashes from the east to the west, okay? It's going to be that fast, okay? So if someone tells you to go out and meet Christ over there or over here, don't believe him because he's going to come so fast and we have to be ready. We have to be ready. And the coming of the Son of Man brings great destruction upon the planet. Okay. When he comes for us in the clouds. But look at what he says in verse 26 of Luke chapter 17. Just as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the days of the Son of Man. They were eating and drinking and marrying and being given in marriage until the day when Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Okay. So God is telling us that when this day comes, it's going to be is going to be worldwide. Okay, the destruction is going to be worldwide. And business is going to be carrying on as usual, just as it was in the days of Noah. In the days of Noah, everything was the same. Up until the point when Noah went into the ark, God shut the door, and the rain began 7 days later. Everything was going on as normal. Okay, but when the flood came, hallelujah, like he says right here, when the flood came, there was no chance for anyone on the outside of the ark to get into the ark. And the destruction was worldwide, cataclysmic. Likewise will the end of the age be worldwide and cataclysmic, except this time it's going to be a flood of fire and not a flood of water. Okay, so as it was in the days of Noah, it's going to be a worldwide judgment, but this time by fire. And now look at else. Look what else he says about the end days judgment. Verse 28, likewise, just as it was in the days of Lot, they were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. But on the day when Lot went out of Sodom, fire and sulfur rained from heaven and destroyed them all. So will it be on the day when the Son of Man is revealed. Okay, so here we even get more clues about what that day is going to be like. Likewise, it's going to be just like it was in the days of Lot. It's going to be a regular day, a normal day. Everything's going to be happening just as it is today. Yes, there's tribulation everywhere we look. Okay, John told us in the book of Revelation that he was our companion in tribulation. Okay, the tribulation on the earth right now it has been going on since sin has been in the world. Okay. Yeah, but there's going to come a time when the great tribulation comes, okay? And the great tribulation is the 70th week of Daniel, okay? When the Son of Man is revealed on the clouds, okay? When the Son of Man is revealed on the clouds to begin it all, the day of the Lord, okay? But up until that point, everything is normal. But on that same day, okay, when Lot was taken out of Sodom, on the same day when Lot was taken out of Sodom, the same day that the church is taken out of the world, fire and sulfur will rain down from heaven and destroy everything. Okay? Okay? Just as it was in the days of Noah, worldwide destruction. Everything was the same up until the rain started coming down. Likewise, in the days of Lot, everything was normal. Until the day that Lot went out of Sodom and fire and brimstone rained down on Sodom and Gomorrah. It's going to be the same way when Jesus Christ comes on the clouds. And so I want to show you this in the Old Testament. In the book of Exodus, we're going to see the same pattern played out. Okay, because when the end days come, when the rapture comes, when we're saved, okay, when we're saved out of this time, okay, when we're taken up into the Father's house, okay, there's going to be an order of events, okay, and the darkness comes after, okay, the darkness comes after the hailstorms. The darkness comes after, okay, that 3 days of darkness in Egypt was after the hail had come, okay. Look at this. Let me just show you the overview first, okay. Okay, so the seventh plague of hail. The seventh plague of hail represents what's going to happen when Jesus Christ comes on the cloud. Okay, when Jesus Christ comes on the cloud, there's going to come thunder and hail and fire. Okay, thunder, hail, and fire, an earthquake is going to shake everything up on the planet. And those who listen to take shelter, meaning those who have confessed Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, we'll enter into our chambers at this time. We're going to enter into our chambers and we're going to be sheltered from the plague of hail. We're going to be sheltered from the time of trouble. We see that playing out right here. Let me read verse 13. And the Lord said unto Moses, rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For I will at this time send all my plagues upon your heart and upon your servants and upon your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. For now I will stretch out my hand that I may smite you and your people with pestilence, and you shall be cut off from the earth. And in very deed for this cause have I raised you up, for to show in you my power, that my name may be declared throughout all the earth. As yet exaltest yourself against my people, and you will not let them go? Behold, tomorrow, about this time, I will cause it to rain a very grievous hail, such as has not been in Egypt since the foundation thereof, even until now. Send therefore now and gather your cattle and all that you have in the field, for upon every man and beast which shall be found in the field and shall not be brought home, the hail shall come down upon them, and they shall die. He that feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his cattle flee into the houses. And he that regarded not the word of the Lord left his servants and his cattle in the field. Okay, so this is a picture of the rapture. Okay, God is extending his grace and his mercy even to the Egyptians. He says, if you fear what I have said to you, if you fear my power, if you fear the judgment to come, and if you not only fear, but you obey what I've told you to do, okay? Because it's not just the hearers of the word, but the doers of the word, okay? You have to do something in the days of Egypt to escape this seventh plague. You have to not only fear what God had said, but you have to do what God had said in order to find shelter from the soul. And God says, this invitation is given even unto the Egyptians to escape this great hailstorm. And the only way to escape was to take you and even your animals from out of the field and bring them into your house. Okay, that was the only way. That was the only way to escape, okay? Because God, look what God says. This is what the Bible says, okay? Let me read verse 19. Send therefore now and gather your cattle and all that you have in the field, for upon every man and beast which shall be found in the field and shall not be brought home, the hail shall come down upon them and they shall die. Okay, everyone who didn't listen to what God said to do, they died. Okay, if you were left outside when the hailstorm came, you died, both you and your animals. Okay, God is not mincing words. Okay, this is the truth. You either believe God or you don't. Okay, everyone, likewise in our day, everyone who has not been born again, who has not trusted in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, everyone who doesn't have oil in their lamps, who have no relationship, no fellowship, no intimacy, okay? Everyone who does not know Jesus and Jesus does not know them, on the day when the hail comes, you're going to be left behind and you just might die. Okay. You're of course going to be dead in your trespasses and sins and declared unclean. And because of that, you're left behind, but you might even die in the judgment of the hail. Okay, because while this judgment of hail was just local, it was localized to just Egypt, the hailstorm that's coming on the cloudy day is going to be worldwide. It's going to be a worldwide hailstorm. Okay, a worldwide hailstorm that's going to drop 100-pound hailstones upon the planet. Okay, and the Bible tells us in the book of Revelation that the people who are left behind will blaspheme the name of God for the plague of the hail, because that plague will be exceedingly great. Okay? And many people are going to die when the hailstones fall upon the cloudy day. But for those who know this before it happens, which is right now, we know what's coming, you can escape into the Father's house, because the Bible tells us that he invites us to come into our chambers for a little moment and shut the doors behind us until the indignation is passed. Look at it in the book of Isaiah. It tells us to do that. God invites us. He invites us into the Father's house. He invites us to come into the Father's house and be sheltered. Hallelujah. To be sheltered from this indignation of hail. Okay. Just as the Egyptians were offered an olive branch. Okay. Of mercy. Okay. And those who feared the word of the Lord, they did it. Look at verse 20, Isaiah chapter 26. God says, come, bo in the Hebrew. Come, my people. Okay, it's not Only his people are going to do this. Okay, now if you don't fear the word of the Lord, well, you don't belong to him. Okay, if you don't fear the word of the Lord and obey the word of the Lord, well, you're not his people. Okay, but for his people, those who name the name of Christ, those who have set their seal to this, that God is true. Look at what God tells us to do. He invites us to come, find shelter, enter into your chambers. Okay. The Father's house has many mansions. Hallelujah. There's many rooms, many abiding places, and your name is on your chamber. Hallelujah. Because he's inviting his people to come. Okay. Come and find shelter. And look, he tells us to shut your doors behind you. Okay. He's telling us to do like, Noah did. Okay. Do like Noah did. Okay. Enter into the ark of safety. Okay, and shut the door behind you. Although in the days of Noah, God shut the door. And likewise, God's going to shut the door when we go into the Father's house. It's his house. Hallelujah. Okay, but when we go into our special room, hallelujah, that he provided for us, we're going to hide ourselves, as it were, for a little moment. Okay, we're going to be there for about an hour. Hallelujah. Because we're going to the Father's house. Hallelujah. What a joyous occasion. We're going into eternity. Oh my goodness. We're going into, I can't even imagine it. You know, it's the dwelling place of God. I mean, 7 years are going to pass on the earth. It's going to be just for a little moment, okay? Just for a little moment, we're going to get a glimpse, hallelujah. But that glimpse is going to last forever because we're never going to leave his presence, hallelujah. Where he goes, we go, because we are co-heirs with the king. We are married to the Lamb, hallelujah. And so once we go into the Father's house, we're going to hide ourselves for a little moment. Until the indignation be overpassed. Hallelujah. Because what's the indignation? Well, it tells us right here, verse 21, for behold, the Lord comes out of his place. Okay, it's the Lord coming. He's coming. He's coming. You better believe it. He's coming. Okay, that's it. That's all. I mean, the choice is yours to believe it, but even if you don't believe it, he's still going to come. Okay, it's his show, his universe. Okay, we're his creatures. He's the potter. We're the clay. He's coming. He's coming whether you believe it or not. He's going to come. And when he comes and if you don't believe, well, he's coming to do this. He's coming to punish. He's coming to bring out that wood. Okay, he's going to bring out that paddleboard. Okay, he's going to bring out that rod. Okay, and that rod is going to smite. Okay, that rod is going to smite. Okay, and he's going to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. The earth shall also disclose her blood and shall no more cover her slain. Okay, when God comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity, okay, this isn't a pretty thing. Okay, it's not a pretty thing if you're left behind. As a matter of fact, it's a terrible thing. It's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But for those who know him, we get invited to the Father's house, the place that Jesus Christ, he promised to prepare for us, hallelujah, and take us to be where he is at, so that where he is, we may be also, okay? Because he has many abiding places in his Father's house. And so, likewise, okay, what happened in Egypt with the seventh plague, it's going to happen in our days, okay? So if you're left behind, there's a good chance that you will die, okay, in the plague of hell, okay? Because 1/4 of all mankind will die at the beginning of the judgment. But if you do survive, okay, if you do survive, this is what's going to happen. Okay, let's keep on reading. Let's go to Exodus chapter 10, because look what comes next. After the cloudy day comes, okay, after the cloudy day comes, let me just show you this. Let me just show you this. Once this happens, Isaiah 19, look at this. Okay, the burden of Egypt. Behold, the Lord rides upon a swift cloud and shall come into Egypt, and the idols of Egypt shall be moved at his presence, and the heart of Egypt shall melt in the midst of it. Okay, when God comes on the swift cloud, that's when we go up, the body of Christ goes up to meet him in the clouds. But if you're left behind, Egypt represents the world. When he comes into to shake the world, when he comes out of his place, to shake the world, which is Egypt, everything's going to be moved at his presence. Okay, the idols are going to be moved. Every man is going to be moved. Everything that creeps upon the ground is going to be moved. Even the mountains and the islands are going to be moved. And everyone is going to be in fear and dread. Okay, because God is coming to pour out his wrath upon the earth. And because he's coming on the cloud, that lets us know that that's where the hailstones are at. Okay, I've gone over this many times in my teachings, but let me just go over one more time. Because you can never say the word of God enough in order to paint the picture. Okay, when God comes on the cloud, this is what comes. Okay, this is what comes if you're left behind. Okay, verse 9. This is Psalm 18. This is all about the rapture. This is the rapture chapter. It's also interesting that it's the 18th Psalm and we're in the year 2018. I'm looking for him. Hallelujah. I'm watching and I'm praying. I'm expecting him. Hallelujah. He's going to come. Hallelujah. And so I'm going to keep on watching. I'm going to keep on praying always. Okay. I'm going to do what the Bible says. Okay. I'm going to do what God told me to do. No matter what, okay, because for so long I did what I wanted to do, and I almost ended up in the lake of fire. But God had mercy on me. He snatched me out of that fire. He snatched me from the clutches of hell. He snatched me from the devil's hands, okay? I didn't choose him. He chose me, hallelujah. And now because I'm rocking with the new master, now because I have new marching orders, I'm following what the king does, okay? Am I perfect? No, but I'm aiming for perfection, just like Paul did. Okay, I'm aiming. I haven't arrived yet, but I'm aiming. Hallelujah! And I'm not gonna quit aiming. Okay, I'm gonna keep on striving. I'm gonna keep on pushing. I'm gonna keep on pressing. I'm gonna keep on seeking. Okay, there's victory in Jesus. Hallelujah! Okay, he's the conqueror. Hallelujah! He's the conquering king, and all those who are in Christ, we always triumph in him. Hallelujah! Because he's already won. Okay, so on the cloudy day, when he comes on his cloud, look what happens. He bowed the heavens also and came down. Okay, remember, he's coming out of his place, as Isaiah 26 tells us. And look what comes. Darkness is under his feet. Okay, the day of the Lord is darkness and not light. It is even very dark with no brightness in it. Okay, the Bible tells us that one third of the sun is smitten, one third of the moon is smitten, and one third of the stars are smitten on this day. And they did not shine and give their light, because the day of the Lord is darkness and not light. Okay, but that's not the 3 days of darkness. You got to be up here in the clouds with him on this day, because if you're left behind, well, you're seeing something totally different. Okay, you want to be in the Father's house for that hour. You want to be before the throne. You want to see Jesus face to face. You want to be enamored with the glories of heaven. Okay, it may only be for an hour, just for that little brief moment. Hallelujah, because we're in eternity and there is no time in eternity. It's forever, but it's going to seem like an hour. Okay, but it's really going to be 7 years on the earth. You want to be in the Father's house for that hour. Okay, you want to be in your chamber for that little moment. You don't want to be under the clouds. You don't want to be under his feet. Okay, yes, if you survive when he comes down, if you survive this day, you still have a chance to get into heaven, but you're going to have to go through the tribulation. But it's going to be so much harder at that time. If you can't come to him today while there's peace, quote unquote, while there's a, it's still the tribulation of our days, but it's not the great tribulation. Okay, we still have a little bit of freedom here and there. Okay, to go out and witness, to go out and preach, to go out and share the good news, to go out and read the Bible. Okay, but when the cloudy day comes, when the cloudy day comes, and you're left behind on the earth, and you survive it, and then you have to see the enemy. And you have to see the wicked one. Okay, the Bible says about that day that man will seek high and low, far and wide. They're going to go from the north to the east, from sea to sea, looking for the word of the Lord, but will not find it. Okay, because the famine will be in the land. Okay, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. Okay, in that day, the young men and fair virgins shall faint for thirst. Okay? It's the day of evil, okay? All the Bibles are outlawed. It's a death sentence to speak the name of Jesus. Can't even say the name of the Lord. Okay? It's the night when no one can work. Okay? There is no missionary activity. Okay? There is no evangelism outreach. Okay? There is no street corner preaching. There is no going to church. Okay? There is no Bible study. Okay? It's 666. Okay? Okay? It's the day of wrath and indignation. Fire is everywhere. Food is scarce. Okay? Cannibalism is rampant. It's every man for himself. Okay? Law and order has broken down, and then the wicked one appears. Okay? And then he's going to come with all subtlety and lying signs and wonders, and the whole world is going to follow after this guy. And for those who are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, if their names aren't written in the Lamb's Book of Life, they're going to even take his mark and damn their souls to hell. Okay, but everyone who is written in the Lamb's Book of Life during this time and you're left behind, well, you won't take the mark of the beast. Hallelujah. But most likely you will die. You will give up your life for the faith unless you make it to the wilderness. But that's a whole nother teaching. Let me get back to this, when God comes on the cloud. Okay, so Psalm 18, verse 9. He bowed the heavens also and came down, and darkness was under his feet. And he rode upon a cherub and did fly. Yeah, he did fly upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness his secret place. His pavilion round about him were dark waters and thick clouds of the skies. At the brightness that was before him, his thick clouds passed, hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the highest gave his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. Okay, so the hailstones go before him, my friends. It's a hailstorm of destruction when he comes. You just can't even imagine it. But look what the book of Revelation tells us about this day. The book of Revelation paints the picture. When Jesus Christ comes, when the sixth seal is open, the whole seven seal scroll is open on the cloudy day. Okay, he has the power to take the scroll before the temple in heaven is open from the Father. And once he takes it, he opens it and everything is manifested. Okay, the whole seven seal scroll is manifested. The first four trumpets are blown, and that begins the day of the Lord. Okay. Now, if you're not taken up instantaneously into the Father's house, you're going to see it all worked out on the planet. And there's a good chance you might be one of those one in four people who die, okay, that are left behind just from this judgment when God comes. This is God coming, okay? I just can't, you just can't imagine how catastrophic this day is. This isn't just some localized event. You know, people... I listen to people talk and, you know, I read some stuff, but, you know, the full magnitude of this day, okay, the full magnitude of this day is incomprehensible, okay, really, it is. That's why God says it's a day of perplexity in the valley of vision. That's what the Bible says. I go by what the Bible says, okay? The Bible paints the picture, and the prophet Isaiah said it's a day of perplexity, okay? It's a day of perplexity. Okay, this day is a day of perplexity, my friends. We can't imagine this day. Okay, this day when it all begins, when the world you see today, if you're left behind, it's not going to be that world anymore. It's not. There's no more going to the movies. There's no more television. There's no more entertainment. There's no more going to the bars. There's no more football. There's no more clubbing. There's no more nothing of that. Okay, there's no more going to McDonald's. There's no more going to Walmart. There's no more going to Target. There's no more going to Vons. No more going to Albertsons. No more shopping. No more Amazon. Okay, no more of that. Okay, just none of it. Okay, none of it will remain. None of it. Okay, none of it will remain. Okay, everything is going to be shaken. Okay, this is the day of perplexity, according to God himself. Okay, because God was the one who was speaking through the prophet Isaiah to give us the picture. Okay, this is his strange work. Okay, this is his strange work. Okay, and when it begins, it's incomprehensible, the level of destruction that's going to come on the planet. Incomprehensible, but it's going to come. It's coming, my friend. It's coming. And you just don't want to be left behind to see it. You don't want to be left behind to see when it all manifests on the earth. You want to have the vantage point of heaven. You want to have the vantage point of the clouds. You want to be focused on Jesus. Okay? Because he's going to keep us in perfect peace. Okay? He'll keep those whose minds are stayed on him in perfect peace. Okay? We can't be shaken if you're looking to him. Okay, if your eyes are fixed on Jesus, when this day happens, we're translated instantaneously, taken up into the Father's house. Hallelujah. Glorified with new bodies forever. Hallelujah. And we're before the throne praising him forever and ever. Okay, that's our vantage point if you're born again. But if you're not born again, well, you're just going to have to see all this. Okay, you're going to have to see all this, and it's going to be devastating. Okay, now look what happens when this happens. The sixth seal. This is what happens. This is when Jesus Christ comes to get us. This is all manifested on the cloudy day. Okay? And the sixth seal tells us this. Verse 12, and I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. This is the Gog and Magog earthquake. This is the Babylon earthquake. Okay? This is the worldwide earthquake that shakes everything. Okay? Okay, let me just go here. I got 20 minutes. Hallelujah. I want to make this connection because this was another question just came to my mind. Another person asked me about Babylon the Great and the connection with the rapture. Okay, Babylon the Great, which is the United States of America, is destroyed when all this happens. Okay, when the whole world shakes, Babylon the Great is the biggest casualty of this whole event. Okay, because Babylon the Great is the nation that's in charge of the whole world at this moment. But once this day comes, Babylon the Great is wiped off the map, and the attention of the world goes back to the old world, specifically Israel, Jerusalem, the time of Jacob's trouble. Okay, this new world that we live in, that was colonized, you know, when Columbus came over, you know the story. You know, I don't want to get into the history lesson, but we, you know, that's a whole nother story. But this is the new world over here in America. Okay, I live in America. I don't know where you may be at, but this is the new world. America is Babylon the Great, and America is the one who rules over all the kings of the world right now. There's no debate about this. Okay, really, there really isn't. There's no debate about who runs the show, who has the best military, the biggest military, who has the most nuclear weapons, who wants to go up into space now and have a space force, okay? There's no debate about who that country is, who that nation is, that God says is the most proud, that God says believes that it can never be destroyed, who God says that has a mother country who will see her fall, who God says is the last of all the nations, okay? That nation is America, okay? That nation is America, okay? It's Babylon the Great. So when Babylon the Great falls, it falls on this day when God comes on the clouds. When he comes to rapture us, Babylon the Great falls. And let me just show you this connection in the book of Jeremiah, how the whole world shakes when Babylon falls, okay? Even in the Old Testament, you know, God tells us about this same event, this worldwide earthquake. Okay, so we know that ancient Babylon, the whole world didn't shake when ancient Babylon was captured. The Bible tells us what happened when ancient Babylon was captured in Daniel chapter 5. Daniel chapter 5 tells us that Belshazzar was having that drunken feast, and Babylon was captured in the night without even a struggle. Okay, history, secular history even records it. Okay, Babylon still existed long after she was taken over by the Medes and Persians. Okay, even the story of Daniel in the lion's den occurred in Babylon. Okay, Babylon continued to exist after she was taken over by the Medes and Persians. So the total destruction of Babylon the Great, Babylon the Great, what's written about it in the Old Testament about Babylon applies to Babylon the Great. And this is one such instance, verse 46. At the noise of the taking of Babylon, the earth is moved, and a cry is heard among the nations. Okay, so this word for moved is ra'ash. That means earthquake, okay? So when Babylon is taken, the Bible says that the whole earth will shake. Okay, that's the greatest earthquake in human history. And then a cry is heard among the nations. That's what you read about in Revelation 18, when the people on the sea are crying because of the smoke of her torment, when the merchants of the earth wail and lament over her and bewail for the destruction of Babylon the Great, because no one will buy their merchandise anymore. So let me just show you the Hebrew word for this. When Babylon is destroyed, the whole earth, okay, the whole earth, that's aretz. Aretz is the land, the earth. So the whole earth is going to be shaken, okay? The whole earth is moved. That's ra'ash, okay? The same word for quake, to shake. Ra'ash, shake, okay? Quake, okay? Earthquake, okay? The whole earth is made to tremble. Quake, okay? The whole earth shakes on this day, okay? The whole earth shakes, okay? This wasn't fulfilled when ancient Babylon was destroyed. When the destruction of Babylon happened in the days of Belshazzar, it wasn't a destruction. It was just a takeover by the Medes and Persians. Therefore, God is telling us something more about the Babylon to come, Babylon the Great. And so when we get the meat in the book of Revelation, we see how the whole earth shakes when Babylon falls. Okay, so we see that the whole earth shakes here when Babylon falls. And we also see that connection about that worldwide earthquake with the connection of Gog and Magog, which also happens in conjunction with the fall of Babylon. Gog and Magog, the fall of Babylon, are all connected to the same day of sudden destruction. At the same time that Babylon the Great is destroyed, it's going to be the same time when Russia, which is going to be one of the leading nations to destroy Babylon the Great by fire, it's going to be the same day that they try to attack Israel. Okay, it's a double whammy on that day. It's a double whammy of a sneak attack, okay? It's a double whammy of coming against Babylon on every side, which is America, and at the same time, it's a double whammy of trying to come against Israel from every side, okay? But at the same time when it's all happening, God comes, okay? That's why it's a day of perplexity, okay? You won't even have time to think when this day happens, okay? And when this day happens, the whole world shakes, okay? And we see that here in Ezekiel 38, verse 19. God tells us that in his jealousy and in the fire of his wrath, surely when that day comes, there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel. Okay, so that shaking is the same Hebrew word, ra'ash. That's what I wanted to show you. Ra'ash. Okay, ra'ash, a quaking, a shaking, an earthquake. Okay, it's the same Hebrew word. Okay, and we know from Ezekiel 38, that this earthquake, this shaking that's going to take place when Gog and Magog comes against Israel, this earthquake extends to the whole world. Okay, so let's look at this. For in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath, this is verse 19, have I spoken, surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel, so that the fishes of the sea and the fowls of the heaven and the beasts of the field and all creeping things that creep upon the earth and all the men that are upon the face of the earth shall shake in my presence. And the mountains shall be thrown down, and the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. And I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains, saith the Lord God. Every man's sword shall be against his brother. And I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood. And I will rain upon him and upon his bands and the many people that are with him, and overflowing rain and great hailstones, fire and brimstone. Thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Okay, so the same great earthquake that shakes Babylon, which shakes the whole world at the time Babylon falls, is the same worldwide earthquake that we read about here, we just read, which is also connected with the hailstones, Okay, the fire and the brimstone that will rain down, which is also connected to the sixth seal, which is where we're at right here. When the sixth seal is open, there's a great earthquake. This is the worldwide earthquake when God comes on the cloud. Okay, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. That's a connection to when the day of the Lord begins. And the stars of the heaven fell upon the earth. That's the hailstones and coals of fire, as well as the heavens being shaken, which will shake out all those fallen angels who rebelled with the enemy down to the earth. Even as a fig tree is casting her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island removed out of their places. Okay. God says every mountain and island, okay, not some, not a few, every mountain and island, okay, was moved, okay? That means that the whole topography of the earth is going to change on this day, okay? And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? Okay, so this is the devastation that comes on the cloudy day, which is connected with the hailstones, okay? The hailstones that fall, okay? The hailstones that fall on the planet, okay? And that's the connection I wanted you to see with Exodus chapter 9, with the seventh plague of hail. Okay, when the seventh plague of hail came upon Egypt, Egypt was totally destroyed. Those who feared the Lord, they were spared. Okay, the same thing is going to happen in our day. Those who fear the word of the Lord were spared from this time. We're taken to the Father's house. We're raptured. But if you're left behind, this is what comes. Okay, now we're getting to the lesson that I wanted to get to when I first started. Hallelujah. Okay, so after the plague of hail, what happens next? Okay, the locusts come. Okay, the locusts come. Okay, and then the darkness comes. Okay, that's the order. It's the hail, then the locust. Then the darkness, okay? That's where you get your 3 days of darkness, okay? The 3 days of darkness that fell upon Egypt represents the 3.5 years at the end, the last 42 months, when darkness will set in, when the Antichrist reveals who he truly is, okay? But even before that, the locusts come, and that's the same order of events that we see in the Bible, okay, in the book of Revelation, okay? In the book of Revelation, we just went over what happens when it all begins, which is the hailstones, okay? The hailstones come first, when the cloud comes, okay? This is the rapture, okay? The seventh plague of hail, this is the rapture. I just went over how this was a type of the rapture when God extended to even the Egyptians to escape from it, okay? That represents the Gentiles, those who have been grafted in into the vine of Israel. We're going to enter into our chambers, okay? And we're going to be spared from this. But if you're disobedient and you don't fear the word of the Lord, well, you're going to be left behind. And look what God says. Well, this is what comes next. Let me read this right quick. Verse 7. And Pharaoh's servant said unto him, how long shall this man be a snare unto us? Let the men go that they may serve the Lord their God. Knowest thou not yet that Egypt is destroyed? Okay, so this represents the world after the hail falls, okay? The whole world is destroyed. We just read it in so many places how the whole world is going to be changed. This whole topography is changed. It's altered. The whole world is destroyed, okay? The whole world is made desolate, okay? Because of the plague of the hail that will fall on the cloudy day when God comes out of his place to begin it all. Okay, to destroy Gog and Magog, to give unto Babylon the fierceness of his wrath, okay? And it begins with the greatest earthquake in human history, the 100-pound hailstones, and every wall falling to the ground, every island and mountain moving out of their places. We read it, okay? We just read it. This is what the Bible says, okay? And then if you're left behind, the world is destroyed. Egypt is destroyed. That's the world. It's destroyed, okay? But then the locusts come, okay, and that's the eighth plague. And so we see that here in the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation, okay, after the first four seals are blown, okay, so the whole seven seal scroll is open, and then the first four trumpets are also blown. That's why the first trumpet is the hail and the fire mingled with blood. Okay, the third of the trees is burnt up, and all green grass is burnt up. The fires begin. Okay, the whole world is going to be cleansed by fire. The day of the Lord is just destruction. This whole world is destroyed by fire. Okay, there's fire everywhere. Fire, fire. Fire is everywhere. Okay, and the first four trumpets are blown at the same time. This is the hailstones, okay, that come from the clouds. The great mountain, which is the second trumpet, that's Babylon, all burning on fire. The third trumpet is wormwood. Okay, the great star that falls from heaven that makes the waters bitter. And then the fourth angel, this is when the third of the sun, the third of the moon, and the third of the stars are darkened. Okay, for the day of the Lord is darkness and not light. Okay, it is even very dark with no brightness in it. Okay, and then that's going to be the condition of the world for the first 3.5 years of the tribulation. Okay, and then there's a pause. There's a half hour of silence. Okay, a half hour of silence when heaven is silent. The only two witnesses on the planet are going to be the two witnesses from Jerusalem. That's the only two lights during the first half of the tribulation. Okay, the Antichrist, he rises to power. He takes over. The whole world thinks he's a Messiah. Everyone's following after him. His only opposition are the two witnesses. Okay, but at the midpoint of the tribulation, that's when heaven will speak again. And that's when the fifth trumpet blows. Okay, and the fifth trumpet is the locust. Okay, the locust from the bottomless pit. Okay, just like we see in Exodus. After the hail came the locust. Okay. After the hail came the locust, okay? And that's exactly what happens in the book of Revelation. After the hail comes the locust, the fifth trumpet, at the midpoint of the tribulation, which begins the last 42 months. And then after the, and then this is when the darkness sets in, okay? The darkness sets in because the last 42 months is when the Antichrist makes war with everyone who will not worship him as God, okay? And then we even get the literal darkness with the fifth bowl. Okay, the fifth bowl even has the literal darkness. Okay, when the fifth bowl is poured out during those last 42 months, at the end of those last 42 months, look at what the fifth bowl says. This is Revelation 16 verse 10. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness. And they gnawed their tongues for pain and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores and repented not of their deeds. Okay, and that's the same order that we see here in Exodus. Okay, the first we see was the hail. Okay, that comes on the cloudy day. Then at the midpoint of the tribulation, the locusts come, the bottomless pit. And then after the locusts, the darkness. Okay, the darkness which even may be felt. Okay, the darkness comes, okay? That's the order of events, and that's the same thing that we see in Amos. For out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, every matter is established. Now look at Amos, okay? This is, Amos saw three visions, but you have to read the visions in reverse. Starting from the plumb line to the fire to the locust. Okay, the plumb line is verse 7. This is the plumb line. This is the first vision that in the order. You have to read it upwards, okay? So the first vision is the rapture. This is when, let me just read it. Thus he showed me, and the Lord stood upon a wall made by a plumb line with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said unto me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then said the Lord, behold, I will set a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will not again pass by them anymore. Okay, so this is when God stands up to measure the whole earth. Okay, this is when he measures everyone's foundation. Those who are ready are taken into the Father's house, were hidden, okay? But those who don't measure up to his perfect standard of righteousness are left behind. And what happens if you're left behind? Well, you see the fire, okay? Then the fire comes, okay? And we see this here. Verse 4, okay? So this is the second thing that will come if you're left behind. Okay, if you're left behind, you're not taken up. You're not on the wall with the Lord. You're left behind, and this is what you see. You see the fire. Verse 4, thus hath the Lord showed me unto me, and behold, the Lord God called to contend by fire, and it devoured the great deep, and it did eat up a part. Okay, so the fire comes. That's the hailstones. That's the coals of fire. That's Revelation when the first trumpet blows. Okay, when the first trumpet blows, and the hailstones and the fire come down on the earth, and all the green grass is burnt up. Okay, a third of the trees is burnt up. Okay, the world is cleansed by fire in the end of days. Okay, and that's the judgment that comes. You're not ready. You're not on the wall with the Lord. Your foundation is shaky. Well, you're going to be enter into the fires of the great tribulation. And then what happens after the fire? Then the locusts come, okay? Then the locusts come. Verse 1, thus hath the Lord God shown unto me, and behold, he formed grasshoppers in the beginning of the shooting up of the latter growth. And lo, it was the latter growth after the king's mowings. Okay, so the locusts come after the rapture. Okay, this is even a rapture verse right here. Look at this. The sovereign Lord showed me a vision. I saw him preparing to send a vast swarm of locusts over the land. This was after the king's share had been harvested from the fields, and as the main crop was coming up. Okay, ESV says, this is what the Lord God showed me. Behold, he was forming locusts when the latter growth was just beginning to sprout. And behold, it was the latter growth after the king's mowings. Okay, the king's mowings is what happens on the cloudy day when he sticks in his sickle and he harvests the body of Christ. Okay, but if you're left behind, okay, you're going to be part of that latter growth when it starts to sprout, and the locusts are going to come. Okay, the locusts are going to come, and it's going to be terrible. Men are going to seek death and not find it. They're going to desire to die, but death will flee from them. Okay, and so I hope you saw the pattern. Okay, the fire comes first. I mean, the cloudy day comes first with the hailstones and coals of fire. Okay, fire sweeps over the land. Okay, and then the locusts come, okay, and darkness sets in. Okay, that's the order of end times events in a nutshell. Okay, we see the same thing in Joel chapter 2, the day of the Lord. Blow a trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm on my holy mountain, the rapture. Okay, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble. Okay, the earthquake. Okay, that's the earthquake. Okay, then it talks about the day of the Lord and describes it. Okay, the day of the Lord is darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. That's what happens if you're left behind. Like blackness there is spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful people. Their like was never seen before them, nor will it be again after them through the years of all generations. That's the locusts. Okay, the locusts come. Okay, and then the fire. Okay, the fire goes before them. Okay, the fire has already started. And a fire devours before them. The fire is already on the earth when they come. And behind them a flame burns. The land is like the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness, and nothing escapes them. Their appearance is like the appearance of horses, and like war horses they run. Okay, so that's the same locust that we see here. This locust from the bottomless pit. Okay, the locusts that look like horses. Okay, verse 7, in appearance, the locusts were like horses prepared for battle. Okay, Revelation 9, verse 7. Okay, it's the same thing that Joel is seeing here in Joel chapter 2. Okay, this is the locust invasion from the bottomless pit. Okay, so there is no 3 days of darkness before the rapture. I hope that's clear. Okay, there's no 3 days of darkness that warns anyone. God says we have to be ready. We have to be ready when he comes, because if we're not ready, we're going to be left behind. Okay, that's the bottom line. You can't make up stuff and say this means that and that means that when the Bible says this is what is really going to happen. And we have to be ready. Okay, there's going to be no warning, just as it was in the days of Noah, just as it was in the days of Lot. We have to listen to the messengers before it happens. Okay, and the Bible is our messenger. Okay, God has spoken to us in these last days through his son. Okay, and the word is Jesus. Okay, Jesus is the word made flesh. Everything that we need to know is in the Bible. And if you can't verify it with the Bible, well, you just got to throw it out. Now, that's what I do. Maybe you chew the meat and spit out the bones. But if it doesn't match with the Bible, well, I'm going to spit it all out. Okay, because I need truth. I want truth. That's what I desire. That's what I need. That's what I love. I don't need man's opinions. I need the truth. Okay, because the time is too short. The days are evil. Okay, and I want to be right. And the only one that's right is Jesus. So I'm going to go by what he says in the word of God. So if you have to be ready, have your wedding garments pressed and white. No spot, no blemish. Keep your eyes on Jesus, because he's coming soon. If there's anyone out there that doesn't know you, accept him as your Lord and Savior. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart that he has risen from the dead, and you shall be saved. For God is coming soon, and he says, whoever will call upon his name shall be saved. You can be saved from the hailstones and coals of fire. You can be taken into the Father's house before it all happens. Okay, you don't have to be left behind, but you have to fear what God has said and obey what God has said. There's no shortcuts. God bless you, and I love you. Jesus is coming soon. Amen.